Intelligent Computing Group and General Manager of Esports and Gaming at Intel, John Bonini. Professional skateboarder from Brazil, Leticia Bofoni. President of Japo Sports and Entertainment, Jiamil Fai. And Secretary General of the FAI World Air Sports Federation, Suzanne Schodel. Moderating today's conversation is TRT World News anchor Adnan Nawaz.
Wow, what a fantastic presentation we just heard. Ladies and gentlemen, hello again. So you may realize from my introduction to yesterday's session on combating doping and sport, my obsession with society and culture and how sport fits into those two issues. Sport is, of course, so many things, but primarily, surely, it's about those two things that bind humanity together. However different we are in our looks and the food that we eat, our opinions and our values, we all share an understanding of the importance of a sense of society and a sense of culture. One of the leading countries in terms of making sport a truly organized enterprise was Great Britain. During its period of industrialization in the 19th century, the working week was formalized and the ground rules were laid down for sport being played as an organized activity on Saturdays and Sundays. But then you fast forward to the 21st century and technology is changing the world faster than ever before. And there are two other factors that are also changing the world, the rapid rate of urbanization and demographics. The United Nations says in its figures that there are more young people, young being defined as being between the ages of 10 to 24, there are more people in that age bracket alive today than ever before. So that means, of course, that our societies and our cultures are also changing. So in that context, it's important to understand how the world of sport is changing because societies create sport and sport reflects society. So you've heard the names and titles of our four panelists. So let's begin straight away with the most basic issue is what is the definition of sport? What makes an activity a sport? And John?
I think there's some basic answers that we all know and love. It's got to be competitive. Every sport is competitive. Most sports require some athleticism, but not all sports. And this is the boundary where I think we're debating still. Because some sports require eye-hand coordination. I'm thinking archery or shooting and even race car driving. So I think we're really here debating that question about the boundary. And I think this is, you know, I come from the world of esports. I think one of the reasons it's a sport, it's competitive, requires a lot of training, strategy, but it's that eye-hand coordination that gives it an extra boost as opposed to, say, chess or poker or some other things that are just pure mind games. So I would add that extra part about eye-hand coordination in.
Anybody else? Is there a distinction between a pastime and a sport?
Well, yeah, I think
Suzanne, go on.
I think the competition is very important, but also that in a sport you have somehow a set of rules that you agree to, and you do the same activity and you compare it to each other. So it's part of the gaming. Gaming is something which humans like to do, but then do it according to a common understanding of what you are doing and how you compare it.
Jamil.
Well, I would say my understanding is like the physical activity. For me, doing sport mean moving, you know, doing an activity that could, you know, taking you to competition, as you were mentioning. But today, I think we've seen the evolution of sport. There are sports that were not considered before as, I would say, traditionally as sports. And today we're moving into some games and some other leisure activity that are accepted as sport. But for me, I mean, what I consider as sport from the beginning is something that, you know, bring you to be active. You know, your mind, your body, and
Okay, now this is very interesting, isn't it? Because, of course, the IOC held an esports forum earlier this year in Lausanne. There's been a breakout workshop session on esports as well. And, John, we were discussing the whole debate that we were going to have here. And one of the things that I said to you in an email was we have to discuss about esports and the sense of physical activity that there is. Because we understand that in so many of these new sports that are becoming more and more popular, esports may be at the very top of the tree in terms of the numbers of people involved, in the amount of money that there is in esports as well, and how it's become a competition from having been undoubtedly a pastime that kids like me were playing in our living rooms. But what about the sense of physical activity in esports?
Well, if you look at some of the athletes today that are training, they have nutritionists. They're spending 10 to 12 hours a day training. The calories that they're burning is very high, but when you look at them, they're doing this. So we struggle with the notion of whether doing this is athletic. And I think that's, you know, frankly, the open debate. I would challenge anybody in the audience or watching online to sit and do that for 10 or 12 hours, move your hand 200 actions per minute, which is an indicator they track, and then come answer the question whether that requires some physical activity. It clearly does for people that play and that are the best. I just think we don't get it yet, and that will come.
Well, I think it's also an indication of what's changing in society. I mean, information technology has come up. We are talking about artificial intelligence. There are different needs of how you live in society and how you perform, and I think that feeds back into how sport is organized. So even if we still have the discussion, is esport really, has it the ambition to become an Olympic sport? Is it eligible to become an Olympic sport? But I think how society changes also reflects in the way we organize sports. So naturally, there will be different sports which are not physical activities, and I think even the Olympic motto, higher, faster, stronger, allows for esports gaming to be included in there, isn't it? It shouldn't only be the consideration of physical activity.
Okay,
and of course, for us, drone racing, for example, or aero modeling is also not a pure physical activity.
Jabil, I was going to come to you anyway.
My issue is when John was talking about, like, in esports, you know, you're moving your hands, and my question is, like, how often do you move your hands? Within an hour or 2 hours? And the risk we have here, when you talk about esports, a few years ago we were talking about obesity, then we need to get kids out to move, to do things, and sitting there for hours just playing with the computer, I think it could be an issue. And then how do you make sure those people are active? Because I think the definition, I mean, for the United Nations, when you're talking about getting population people to be active. My question is, are those kids, are those people active in sitting in a room and just...
Yeah, we should differentiate pros, and then my kids at home. Pros who are doing this for a living, I think, spend several hours practicing. My kids at home, they don't get to play as much. We tell them to stop, right? Go outside, go do something, do your homework, do service in the community, whatever. But I think it's different if depending on the audience you're talking to, professionals or the rest of us.
Okay, so we'll come back to esports later. Leticia, your sport, skateboarding, is going to be in the Tokyo Olympics. What are people going to enjoy about skateboarding? What is it about your sport that has made the IOC accept it as an Olympic event?
What is cool about skateboarding is that skateboarding is not only a sport, you know, it's a lifestyle. It's the freedom that you have to go out and do whatever you want, you know, do whatever trick we want, wear whatever you want. And I think people should know more about our lifestyle, you know. And yeah, it's great that it's going to be in the Olympics and we're going to get to show that skateboarding is not only a sport.
Do you compete against men or is it women against women and men against men?
It's women's against women's, but sometimes I compete against men's. But I only do it because I think it pushes my level more. And I'm always skating with guys, so I like competing with them too. But in the Olympics, it's going to be girls against girls.
And then we had the session yesterday here in the plenary hall about women in sport. So skateboarding is something that's very gender inclusive. Men train with women, and you go to the skate parks, there are as many girls as there are boys, men as women.
Skateboarding is like a big family, you know. We skate together, we train together. It's girls, guys, we always together. So it's not like, oh, it's a manly sport. No, we always together. And those days, there's more girls skating. Everywhere I go, I see more girls skating, and it's getting bigger and bigger.
That's got to be surely one of the things that we look at, excuse me, when we look at future sports, is gender inclusivity. And then as relates to esports, there's an issue here for esports.
Yep.
The players who play are very, very much more men than there are women. And there are figures from Australia and China that show between 65 to 75% of esports players are men. How does the industry, the field, address that issue?
Well, I think there's a couple fundamentals we have to address. One of them is, as the industry developed, men developed games, and it turns out boys like to play those games. So it was very, you know, based on who develops the game. So we need more women to code and to be developers. I think that will help. And the second thing is there's a stigma of who plays video games growing up. Boys would grab and play a video game, and girls would go do something different. So there's a cultural norm of what's acceptable. And the problem is, by the time you hit your prime in esports, or the beginning of your prime at age 15 or 16, boys have been playing for 10 years, 8 years, and they're very proficient. You know, girls that are interested, they only have a 1 or 2 years underneath their belt. So between the games, I think we have more games developed by girls, and the acceptable norms within reason. We don't want girls, you know, anybody playing for 10 hours a day that's not a professional. But to have the stigmas and the cultural acceptance of girls playing, I think you'll see a change over the next 10 plus years.
Suzanne, what about in air sports? For example, drone racing. Presumably it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. You know, you're controlling the drone.
Yeah, I have to admit, for air sports, it's also the same. You have a majority of men and less women doing it, but depending on the air sport, high participation, for example, in all parachuting disciplines. In drone racing and aero modeling, traditionally not so many, but we see that there is no difference in the performance. We had a competition in Shenzhen in May. There was a 12-year-old girl that won all categories, so senior, junior, female. So the boys were there, and they were, of course, quite amazed about this performance, so there is no difference. And doors need to be open for girls competing, and it needs to be supported, and I think that's where everybody needs to work on, like in esports as well.
Jamil, so esports is a technology-driven sport. So is air sports, of course. It's technology-driven. Without the technology, the sport wouldn't exist. Is that a challenge for Africa? Esports less popular in Africa, or air sports potentially less popular in Africa because of the IT infrastructure?
Well, I would say it's the issue of perception for air sports. That's what we're talking about, because at the beginning, people hear air sport and they think about airplane, and they don't think that kids or young people could sort of learn and access to the different faces of the sports. And I think that's probably that boundary that maybe Air Sport Federation need to work to sort of engage more people in Africa. Esport is developing very fast. Probably now it's an issue of structuring the sports, because I can tell you every corner of a street, whether you are in Senegal, in Mali, or some other country, you find people organizing the sports. And one of the risks that we have with the sports is, so is betting, because I've seen a lot of kids in Senegal, for example, they organize betting system around the esports competition. And I think there is a need to control that thing very quickly, because then it leads up to violence later on, because, well, there's no set of rules. Yeah. They're organizing themselves. You've lost, you're not happy, so you challenge the other person. And it's the same with, for them, table football. You've seen it in the streets. It happens everywhere. And you've seen a lot of violence coming on. And how do you control this? And how do you make sure that you're not taking kids outside school? Because I've seen cases where kids are not going to school because they've got some esports competition going on. So how do you regulate that sport? I mean, sports, usually when you talk about the definition of sports, you've got a body running the sports, then you've got clubs, you've got federation, you've got rules, and the risk we're going now through is we do not have those rules. So the sport is starting before the rules. Mm-hmm. So there's a need to act very quickly to regulate that those kind of sports.
Yeah, and Suzanne, also to adjust, I think, to how the world is structured in a very different way. I mean, many international federations, I think, are still very much Europe-focused and have this mindset which has been used and practiced for decades. But for us, for example, for certain disciplines like paragliding, it's in Asia, it's a growing and thriving sport, but it's a complete different approach than to the classical, what you hear, powered planes and very expensive and so on. So you need, as an international federation, also to adjust to what's happening in the different regions, and there we are still very distinct. We are living in a globalized world, but if you go to Asia, you will have a complete different mindset, and you need to work in a different way, and the same for Africa. So good prospects for the future, but you need to adjust in a smart way to that, and do it in an inclusive and innovative way.
But this is also an issue because, I mean, to me as an African, there is something that we're always hearing, that the next destination is Africa. And we're still sitting and waiting, and we're waiting for things to come to us. When you look at all these new sports, I mean, how many of them are from Africa? And we do have sport that we could develop and kind of sell to the rest of the world. And I think there are a lot of Africans in this room, and I think it's time we also contribute to the evolution of sport rather than just being consumers. And that's exactly today, we are more consumers than, you know, being proactive and putting offers on the table. That's somehow something that we need to watch.
It's quite clear that there cannot be a full discussion about the future of sport and how to engage the youth without looking at Africa, because it is the fastest growing continent in the world. UN figures show that more than half of global population growth between now and 2050 will happen in Africa. Then the other issue is urbanization, and the figures again from the UN are quite stunning. So these are the numbers of people living in urban areas across the globe. In 1950, it was 30%. In 2014, it was 54%. In 2050, it will be 66%. In other words, a doubling in 100 years. So what about the urban landscape in Africa specifically, Jamil? Is it set up to allow sports in that urban environment?
Well, Adnan, what you're saying is very interesting because, I mean, we've seen that if you look at the evolution of the population between now and 2050, it is said everywhere that Europe is going to be declining, Asia is going to be slowing down, you know, and Africa is going to be going like over 100% in terms of, you know, young population increase. What do we do with these young people? For me, it's like a bomb sitting there. Either we look after these kids, and through sports we can address most of these issues, and if we don't look after these kids, that bomb is going to explode tomorrow, and it's going to be really something that is not going to be nice to see. And I think especially East Asia have shown their power in the last couple of years, and that evolution for Africa, I think, have to bring a better future, a bright future, through even hosting games. Because if you say by 2050 we are going to be an average, you know, the average population in Africa is going to be like 15 to 29 or 30 years old, this means that we can have more athletes, we can host more events. Because, I mean, as a sponsor, I would like to go where people are, where consumers are. And if consumers are in Africa, then we need to have a plan for that. And maybe in this room today, we should have had more African mayors, more African politicians listening, because I heard President Bach saying on the opening that the IOC is here to listen. But I think those politicians in Africa also need to listen to this. They have to change the structures of our cities. Most of the cities we're building in Africa today, we do not have space to do outdoor sports. I look at the case of roller sports in Senegal, which I helped with, I think, Sir Myang, when we had the Olympic flame in Dakar in 2010. We used them to give them exposure. But they have no skate park. They're using the streets. So we should have more smart cities in Africa, open to young people, open to, you know, sports, outdoor sports. And I think that's, for me, the first step to move forward today and give an offer to young people.
The IOC's Olympic Agenda 2020 now allows Olympic host cities to propose staging new sports in their games. In Tokyo 2020, we're going to see baseball, stroke softball, karate, sports climbing, surfing, and skateboarding. And to quote you, Mr. Buck, you said these five sports are an innovative combination of established and emerging youth-focused events, and the IOC also says that these reflect the trend of urbanization in sport. And yet, Leticia, did you actually leave Brazil because you couldn't find the space for skateboarding? You now live in Los Angeles.
Yeah, I moved to Los Angeles when I was 14 because the support in Los Angeles was way more than Brazil, and there was no place to train. It was really hard to find skate parks. And in Los Angeles, like, there's skate parks everywhere. There's place to train. There's street spots. So that's one of the reasons that I moved to LA.
I still think you should do a couple of your tricks right here. Who cares what the
I'll get in trouble.
Manager says.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. It has been discussed, but the skateboard may end up in the first row over there. Okay, so you're not wearing helmets.
Yeah, I don't want to get in trouble.
Suzanne, where do the majority of air sports events take place? In city centers, in fields, outside, in the countryside?
Yeah, definitely not. And I was looking at the at what Jamil said, and, the, and we are traveling to big urban areas all the time. And if you see that, you can't do any air sports there. People jumping off buildings with a parachute on are, this is not an FEI discipline, and we will never make it an FEI discipline. So you can do that with drone racing, with if you have big enough space that you could do some accuracy landing with skydivers or paragliding, but that's a very much a limitation. But I also believe, and I hope actually, people will always want to meet and to socialize, and they will always appreciate to have some opportunity to get out of the urban area into the nature and into green areas and into areas where there is no concrete and where you can enjoy being outside. And that's where we do air sports. And I think that will hopefully always continue to exist. So I even dare to doubt that the progress of urbanization will not stop at a certain time. And people will want to say, I'm not going to live only in this urban area. I will want to be connected to nature.
Can I have a show of hands? Who knows what parkour is? If you know what parkour is, raise your hands.
Wow.
Oof. I'm thinking about, keep, if you keep your hands up, I'm going to try to judge each of your individual ages. Okay, I won't go that far, but you know, that's probably only half of you. And Thomas Bach raises his hand. Surely that is the essence of what sport is about. You use the natural environment, even though it's man-made, the buildings that you're using as your obstacle course, and it's your body performing athletic feats in that environment.
And skateboarding too, I mean, that's
yes.
The rails and stairs and...
Absolutely, now the issue is that all of the sports that we're familiar with when we watch the Olympic Games, and even sports that are Olympic sports but aren't included in the games, they're all driven by the human body. But air sports, is that same definition true of air sports? Because you think, hold on, if there's something powering the mechanism that is the body which through which the athlete performs their stunts, is there a distinction there that becomes troubling for people that you meet when you say, hey, we could be part of an Olympic Games one day?
Yeah, let me include the friends from the other motorsport federations.
Yeah,
automobile,
absolutely.
Motorcycling, power boating. First of all, it's interesting. I think the IOC changed a bit the limitation of what sort of sports are eligible. It used to say no engines, but now it says no thermal engines. So electric engines are somehow included or at least becoming of interest. And the Automobile Federation has a presentation of e-carts here along the Youth Olympic Games. Secondly, I think there is a role of this technology of engines, of aircraft, of cars, of motorcycles for society. So if you use it for a sport, you shouldn't say this is not a sport. It is actually a sport, and it has an overlap into how can you improve the use of engines, of electric engines, and so on. And thirdly, for air sports at least, we don't only use engines. I'm flying planes without an engine. Of course, I need to get up in the air, but my performance is with a technical device which I'm used to perform, there are other sports like skateboarding where you have some device where you do your sports performance. So it shouldn't be that limited. It should be more broader perception and should be accepted as a sporting activity as well. And the range then is going from the classic athletic sports to some sports that use technical devices, maybe even with engines, up to what's virtual with esports.
I'm not sure it matters what we say. I think the people that really get to decide whether something's a sport is the audience. And if they decide motor racing, air sports, skateboarding, esports, that audience gets big enough and it's competitive, I think we will eventually, over the decades of young people grow up, they'll decide, yeah, this has always been a sport. Why are we even, they'll come back and watch these videos and go, that was kind of silly. What were they even talking about? So I just think we're on a transition period where we're asking these questions, and it's fun to be on a panel. I'd like to come back. It's great. But we don't decide. The audience decides.
Yes, the audience might decide, but in the end, it's the governing bodies that are going to decide. They're going to be the ones who are going to have to listen to the audience.
They will follow the audience.
You think? Okay. So
not always every step, but they will eventually come together.
How do you think the IOC in particular is in its receptiveness towards the new sports that you represent? What should it be doing more of? Where is it at the moment, John?
I think currently for esports, they're curious. They're working with us. We already had an event in Pyeongchang that was very successful around StarCraft II game. And we're talking about Tokyo, expanding that a little bit more and doing more. So I think that's good. But it's tough to change a big body, whether it's a government or an IOC body. So the rate of change will be slower than I think would be ideal. But that said, the audience, the gaming community is also curious. They're not sure Olympics belongs with esports, so they're kind of testing that affinity as well. Does it make sense to, get a medal someday or to root for a country as opposed to a person or a team? So I think both sides are curious. Neither one really needs each other yet. But until that community says the Olympics is important, I don't think it'll happen.
Okay, Listen, we're running out of time, so I'm going to have to move on, Suzanne, because I really want you to answer this question. A student in the United States invented software that allows him to surf Google just with his mind. What is technology going to do to sport in the next few decades, Suzanne?
Yeah, I can't help, but I still need to add something to what John said.
Absolutely.
You talked about the Olympics, but maybe it's the Olympic movement which makes the difference.
Yes.
So that might already be an asset. And the role of the international federations is, of course, to pick up sports movements which are becoming global. And to do that in a smart way and not, I know that the snowboarding community didn't like when the skiing federation started getting involved, but in the end, nowadays, I think this is a complete different view that the snowboarders have on that. And we experience the same with all the new disciplines coming up, indoor skydiving, drone racing. People will do that and they will not like us initially unless we do it in a smart way and say, look, we help you to standardize what you're doing so you are becoming a global community. So that's the role of the federations, and maybe the international federations should also think about, are we the ones to recognize esports or e-games actually to become a world championship? Maybe it's not you in the e-gaming community who decide about that or the publishers, but the international federations. And now on the question of the technology.
About technology and the future of sport, what's it going to do? Are we going to see drone racing with just people sitting in their chairs and guiding their drones with their thoughts?
Well, if you want to combine it with a physical activity, I don't know who watched the film Ready Player One from Steven Spielberg. I think that gives a good indication of what it can be in the future. Maybe it develops in this direction, and I think there is still a lot to use in also air sports and other sports.
Virtual realities and augmented realities will be part of sports 20 years, 50 years. That is coming.
They already are for spectators to a certain degree, right. But we're talking about participants here, are we?
Yeah, there's, Battle Royale game today is very popular. Fortnite, if we had everyone raise their hand, I'm sure you've heard of Fortnite. Instead of 100 people playing, thank you, I bet they're... In the future, you could have 10,000 people playing augmented reality version of Fortnite. That stuff like that will come. And it will be running through the cities, by the way, just to go back to your other point. all these things will kind of come together, and new kinds of sports we're just starting to imagine.
Jamil, we've got 2 minutes. I'll tell you what, I will give you a minute and a half of those 2 minutes, and I just want to address this question to you, which could go to anybody. You've worked on all five continents in the world. Some people say there are more continents. When I was doing geography, there were five, okay? So let's stick with five. What do you see in terms of the cultures that you go and work with and that you visit and the way they react to sports, to new sports, to traditional sports? What are people engaging in the most when it comes to youth?
Well, I think it's, yes, I had a chance to probably work and live in the five continents, but they're all different. And probably, I would say some part of Asia and you know, some part of Africa and maybe this part of the world, we have probably a lot of things in common. And I think most of our challenges today is access to sports, is also, you know, you talked about urbanization before. How do we get our cities to be more open for sports practice? And how do we engage more young people and more, I would say, create a balance between elite sports and mass sports participation? Because sometimes there is a big gap between those people that are on top and those people that are kind of at the lower part of the scale and trying to raise up, which need collaboration, I think, between governments, between sports organization and sponsors. And we need to put all these things together using technology. I think today, if I look at what 3-on-3 basketball is doing, which is linking up cities, you know, users, and you know, trying to connect people to do sports without coaches and so on, we should build on something like that. I mean, if I speak about Africa, in terms of giving access to online training to our athletes, because most of our athletes, in fact, I'm going to speak until tomorrow if you let me go.
Yeah, you can see the countdown clock here. Okay, than I can see,
but I think someone changed the clock. It was saying 10 minutes and they put it down to 4.
Okay, John, sorry, we have run out of time. The future of sport is undoubtedly bright, and there is so much more to come. Suzanne, Jamil, Leticia, John, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.